Blackstone Audio presents Twin Beds in Rome by John Updike. This book is read by Peter Van Norden.
Twin Beds in Rome. The Maples had talked and thought about separation so long it seemed it would never come. For their conversations, increasingly ambivalent and ruthless, as accusation, retraction, blow, and caress alternated and canceled, had the final effect of knitting them ever tighter together in a painful, helpless, degrading intimacy. And their lovemaking, like a perversely healthy child whose growth defies every deficiency of nutrition, continued when their tongues at last fell silent, their bodies collapsed together as two mute armies might gratefully mingle, released from the absurd hostilities decreed by two mad kings. Bleeding, mangled, reverently laid in its tomb a dozen times, their marriage could not die. Burning to leave one another, they left, out of marital habit, together. They took a trip to Rome. They arrived at night. The plane was late, the airport grand. They had left hastily, without plans. And yet, as if forewarned of their arrival, nimble Italians, speaking perfect English, took their luggage in hand, reserved a hotel room for them by telephone from the airport, and ushered them into a bus. The bus, surprisingly, plunged into a dark, rural landscape. A few windows hung lantern-like in the distance. A river abruptly bared its silver breast beneath them. The silhouettes of olive trees and Italian pines flicked past like shadowy illustrations in an old Latin primer. "I could ride this bus forever," Joan said aloud, and Richard was pained, remembering from the days when they had been content together how she had once confessed to feeling a sexual stir when the young man at the gas station, wiping the windshield with a vigorous, circular motion, had made the body of the car containing her rock slightly. Of all the things she had ever told him, this remained in his mind the most revealing, the deepest glimpse she had ever permitted into the secret woman he could never reach and had at last wearied of trying to reach. Yet it pleased him to have her happy. This was his weakness. He wished her to be happy, and the certainty that away from her he could not know if she were happy or not formed the final unexpected door barring his way when all others had been opened. So he dried the very tears he had whipped from her eyes, withdrew each protestation of hopelessness at the very point when she seemed willing to give up hope, and their agony continued. "Nothing lasts forever," he said now. "You can't let me relax a minute, can you?" "I'm sorry, do relax." She stared through the window a while, then turned and told him, "It doesn't feel as if we're going to Rome at all." "Where are we going?" He honestly wanted to know, honestly hoped she could tell him. "Back to the way things were?" "No, I don't want to go back to that. I feel we've come very far and have only a little way more to go." She looked out at the quiet landscape a long while before he realized she was crying. He fought the impulse to comfort her, inwardly shouted it down as cowardly and cruel, but his hand, as if robbed of restraint by a force as powerful as lust, crept onto her arm. She rested her head on his shoulder. The shawled woman across the aisle took them for lovers and politely glanced away. The bus slipped from the country dark. Factories and residential rows narrowed the highway. A sudden monument, a massive white pyramid stricken with light and inscribed with Latin, loomed beside them. Soon, they were pressing their faces together to the window to follow the Colosseum itself as, shaped like a shattered wedding cake, it slowly pivoted and silently floated from the harbor of their vision. At the terminal, another lively chain of hands and voices rejoined them to their baggage, settled them in a taxi, and carried them to the hotel. As Richard dropped 600 lira pieces into the driver's hand, they seemed the smoothest, roundest, most tactfully weighted coins he had ever bestowed. The hotel desk was one flight up. The clerk was young and playful. He pronounced their names several times and wondered why they had not gone to Naples. The halls of the hotel, which had been described to them at the airport as second class, were nevertheless of rose marble. The marble floor carried into their room. This and the amplitude of the bathroom and the imperial purple of the curtains blinded Richard to a serious imperfection until the clerk, his heels clicking in satisfaction with the perhaps miscalculated tip he had received, was far down the hall. "Twin beds," he said. They had always had a double bed. Joan asked, "Do you want to call the desk?" "How important is it to you?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.